Good evening, good evening, good evening. Welcome to a prehistory flash with us. We call ourselves the Prehistory Guys. I'm Michael. And
hello. And I'm Rufus. Welcome. Nice to see you.
Prehistory flash. Good evening to you all. There's a lot of names I can see in the chat there that I recognize and a few I don't. So welcome to you as well. However, prehistory flash, what's that all about? Yeah, Rupert and I, we try to pick up things that are in the news and we feel would be a pity if things got missed, if you missed them. You know, maybe they've been in the headlines, maybe they haven't. However, tonight, this evening, this one, it's not really news, is it, Rupert? Can you say a bit more about that? It's not news at all.
It's not any kind of news. It's do you know what? One of the funny things, really, is that because we're trawling the world, literally, trawling the world for new aspects of archaeology that that we can tell you about. And sometimes we come across things almost by accident. We come across things that they're not new at all, but it's like, well, nobody's talked about that in years, and this is actually quite special. So we think that if we haven't seen anything about it, or sometimes it's completely new to us, even though it might have happened 50 years ago, you think, but people should know about this. And tonight is exactly one of these. It's actually a discovery from the 1970s, and the first excavations happened here in the early 70s. This particular discovery that we're talking about was in 1975, but it's the fact that nobody talks about it. And it's too special not to have made a thing to show you.
It has been in the public. It has been in the public domain, but I don't know exactly when. I think maybe 20 years ago or something like that. Who knows? Nevertheless, the fact is it's one of those fascinating things that can be quite impactful, not only about how you think about the thing itself, but also think about archaeology, think about people in the past. So I haven't got a map. That's what I'm missing. I haven't got a map. But we're talking about an excavation on the edge in Denmark, on the edge of the Baltic Sea, so sort of above Copenhagen, over towards the east there, at a place called, the modern town is called Vedbaek. And we're talking about a Mesolithic culture, which we're told is the Ertebella culture, know very little about. I mean, we could extend this program forever, talking about the ins and outs of what they were up to, but we're honing in on one particular thing, one particular burial in one particular cemetery. So, the outline of that, Rupert?
Well, the thing is, the Vedbaek cemetery itself, it's a complex site. There are 17 burials there. Some are single, some are double. I think there's a couple of triple burials as well.
Well, shall I show the
17.
One? You've got a picture of one, at least, so to back you up there.
Yes.
Is that helpful? Yeah. I mean...
Okay, so, in actual fact, that's sort of two thing. Graves. You're looking at... you're looking down at graves 10 and 11 there. On the left, that skeleton that you can see is in grave 10. Now, on grave 11 on the right, you can't actually see the human remains at all. That's a deer antler that is included in the burial. So it's, it's a complex site and the burial's quite rich. Now, what made this really flag up as something that we had to talk about was something that is, as far as we're aware, completely unique. I mean, we certainly have never seen it anywhere else. And that is that there was a young woman buried with a baby, and the baby was nestled on a swan's wing, so that's the picture you're looking at there. There's the mother, obviously the large skeleton. But if you look below her, you can just see the baby's rib cage very clearly there at the bottom of the picture, and that little grey object laying across the baby's stomach, what would have been the baby's stomach, is a It's a flint knife that we can only presume maybe it was the father laid that on top of the baby, you know, for his journey through the afterlife or whatever. You know, we make the stories up because we have no way of knowing. But it was on a swan's wing, which...
Yes, the baby was cradled in a swan's wing.
There's some theorizing that maybe one of the reasons for a swan's wing, because waterfowl are not unknown in burials. It's just the fact that you've got a baby that's nestled in a swan's wing that we've never seen before.
And says full set of teeth, which speaks to something that we've missed out, and her age was 18, and the story goes that she died in childbirth because the child itself was premature, was a newborn, and it was premature. I don't think we'd mentioned that. So that's the scenario. No. You've got mother and baby who died at the same time. In childbirth,
which we've been covering a bit of trauma, haven't we, in our recent prehistory flashes? But one of the theories about this is that maybe waterfowl was significant in or could have been a significant aspect of burials because. The waterfowl, they can fly in the air, they can walk on the land, they can swim on the water. You know, they cross all these different planes of existence, and maybe they're the ideal carriers to, you know, take a spirit into the afterlife, something like that, maybe. Which is, it's a nice thought. Again, we don't know. We just, you know, all we can do is theorize.
But it's one of those art examples of something just hitting us between the eyes from 6,000 years ago. And this is very rare when we get things that we recognize, when we can connect in this way. We've coined the phrase the prehistory of the personal. You know, when we feel that we understand something that was going on and we can relate to it. Just in passing, before we leave it alone, it's an interesting fact that we're talking about the Mesolithic here, and there seemed to be an abundance of burials and remains of Mesolithic people. And they seemed relatively settled in Scandinavia around about this time, where if you look across to us, which is still connected, by the way, isn't it? Sort of? Yeah. Yes. Britain, there's nothing like this at all.
8,000 years ago is when we separated properly from the continent.
We don't get these kind of remains. I just thought I'd mention that. That's a separate issue that that's important from an archaeological point of view and understanding some of the other context around about the Mesolithic there.
We've just been asked a question here. So, is there a radiocarbon date on it? Yes, the actual date is. Go on, Michael. I'm now looking for the actual date.
I've seen nothing more precise than 4000 BC.
4000 BC. Yeah. There might be a more specific one, but 4000 BC. You know, it's close enough.
Yeah.
And you know, the fact that they've been able to tell that that the baby was premature, and you know, I mean, the analysis that people are capable of doing now is fantastic. That it, you know, it enriches these stories no end. You know, when you see the. It's beautiful in its sadness,
but that's the,
we couldn't
that's
not
the point.
Show you this.
Yeah, exactly that. That's its kind of significance. From my point of view, I mean, I think more than any other, this is an example of the personal and the prehistoric. It's the you know, one of the most quintessential examples I can think of. And one of the more poignant narratives that you can actually get from stuff that's in the ground. But the thing is, I think it's also an opportunity to say, hang on, wait a minute, just hold back, because context is everything, not just from an archaeological point of view, but, you know, but how we view things. Yeah. So, you know, anybody who's seen the first episode of Prehistory Flash will know that I'm as soppy as the next person. But, you know, I want to just pull back a bit on this one from the sentiment. Because the fact is, if you do a search, you know, for this, you search for Mesolithic burial, mother and child, swan's wing, or even the Vedbaek burial, grave 8, which is the one you should be looking for, if you find something, more than likely, alongside the archaeological record or people commenting on this or everything, you will often find this image presented alongside it.
It's beautiful, isn't it?
Which is extraordinary. But here we go. Look at the style. That's a very 21st century thing, you know, and it's not an archaeologist's representation. It's not an illustration from an archaeological paper, which you might assume it to be occurring where it does, but that further evokes a resonance in us of a different kind entirely. But this is not an archaeological representation. Or even in a book about the Ertebella culture in Denmark, but it's from a comic book. Or to be more fair, it's actually from a graphic novel. And I'll now show you that image in context.
Yeah.
So, yeah, here's the thing. Once seen in connection with the bare facts of the burial, this is such a strong image. And once you've seen it, you can't really unsee it in connection with these bare archaeological facts. And the feelings that we'll forever associate with mention of this, you know, little particular window into the past becomes fixed. So I really think it's a really great opportunity to notice how our own minds work. And it's a fantastic opportunity to notice that that's what we do when we look at stuff in the past, especially when it's stuff we recognize. So many ancient monuments and stuff in the archaeological record we don't really recognize because it doesn't relate to us in our modern world. That will always relate wherever we are. And our minds will rush off and put meaning on it. You know, that's what we do. There's nothing right or wrong about it.
As soon as something becomes personal, you suddenly become a time traveler. You know, you can completely resonate with the situation.
But it's an opportunity to notice that that's what we do, but we're not necessarily right. Correct, I should say. You know, there's no right or wrong.
Indeed,
about
but,
it.
It's just but equally not necessarily wrong. You just have to emphasize the fact
Right, you know, but a stuck clock is right twice a day. And while we may be right, we're just as likely, if not more likely, to be wrong if we're using our current situation, our current understanding of, you know, mythology and swans and all that to layer it on them. That's all I need to, you know, I just thought more than anything else, it was an opportunity to sort of air those kinds of things. But the find itself, you know, is absolutely brilliant. And however
the fact of the matter is, it's a woman with a baby on a swan's wing. And, you know, the symbolism of that, the everything evocative about it, it's an extraordinary burial, really is.
Is there anything else we can really say that's helpful about it? I mean, I'll leave some links in the description below when I get round to it. But it's one of those things. This could be a long program if we got detailed about it. But the point
is, because obviously, because it's a cemetery with 17 burials, there is obviously an awful lot of information that you can read if you want to. The interesting thing that you'll find in a number of the papers is that they do not focus on this burial at all. We're focusing on it because it is so profoundly personal and recognizable, emotively. From an archaeological point of view, it's just another burial, and a number of the burials are really, you know, they're interesting in themselves, especially the multiple burials. So, there's a lot to be read up about Vedbaek.
Yeah, yeah. Before we go, should mention that the comic, the graphic novel that I mentioned is Mesolithic by Ben Haggerty. It's well worth looking out, actually, because it is a graphic novel set in the Mesolithic.
It's Mesolithic, with a Z, isn't it?
It's spelled with a Z, yes. Published around about 2010, but it was the Times graphic novel of the year that time. So if you're into that kind of thing, I'd say knock yourself out. I think there are three books in the series. It should be fascinating. And the illustrator...
Well, they certainly did their homework on the, you know, on getting the culture right, didn't they, as far as we're aware.
That's right.
So, no, that's why not.
So obviously, that particular illustration was inspired and taken from the knowledge of the Vedbaek burial, but in the context of the story, that wasn't it. So, yeah, I'll leave a link, pointing that out. Ben Haggerty sounds like a really interesting guy, actually, as far as storytelling is concerned, and is interesting.
Yeah, we're going to have to see if we can get hold of him.
So, I'm sort of thinking, that would be cool. Mm. That would be cool. Right. Guys.
Okie dokie. Well,
lovely. It's been lovely talking.
Folks, if you haven't already, help us a lot.
Yep.
And, maybe have a pop over and have a look at our Patreon page if you want to see some of the other stuff that we do.
Yep, yes, indeed.
Meanwhile, I suppose we'll see you next time.
Hope you enjoyed that, folks. I hope you found that valuable, and we look forward to seeing you the next time. All right. Ta-ta for now. Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye.